Donald Sutherland is known for both the wide range of the roles he has chosen and for his idiosyncratic performances. But in each one, he has shown a quality of feeling that has proved to be simply and directly accessible to the audience. The ruthless Nazi in Eye of the Needle is somehow almost as approachable as the decent middle-class father in Ordinary People. He calls himself a director's actor, and perhaps some of his success can be attributed to what he means by that.
The actual working process always seems to me to be pretty successful and happy, and the relationship of the directors in the last 10 years has been really wonderful. I mean, before I had a struggle because I had come from 10 years in the theater in England, and it's a difficult transition to make, moving from being an actor in the theater to an actor in cinema. But when I conquered and realized that, primarily through Nick Rogue in Don't Look Now, he asked me to do the film, and I was making a film in Miami that was really a disaster, and he asked me to do it, and we were talking on the telephone. He was in London and I was in Miami, and he said, I've sent you the script, do you like it? And I said, yes, I think it's terrific, except I think the ending should be changed. And I detailed in 5 minutes of conversation what I thought should happen, and he said, no, the ending stays how as it is. Do you want to do it or not? And I said, oh, okay, yeah. And that was the first time that it became clear in my head that it was truly a director's medium, and that I just had to work for the director. And I delegated any authority that I might have as a performer. You know, sometimes movie actors with a certain amount of success are given more authority than maybe they have the right to have, and that authority I just gave over to the director and used if he needed it in terms of power or whatever, he had it.
Sutherland's name was conspicuously absent from the Oscars nominations for Best Actor for his performance in Ordinary People. But his independent nature and strong belief in his work have made him philosophical about recognition and criticism.
I stopped listening to critics about in 1975, I guess, because it became too painful. There was a criticism of a film called Day of the Locust that was done in the New Yorker by Pauline Kael. John Schlesinger and I were sitting in the Carlyle Hotel in New York. And there were wonderful yellows, really almost Van Gogh colors in the hotel. It was very beautiful. And John was laughing hysterically at this review of the film. It was his adaptation of Nathaniel West's Day of the Locust. And Pauline Kael criticized everything about it. He criticized the book, criticized the location of the book, that we shouldn't have shot it in Hollywood, we should have shot it in Las Vegas, criticized using an English director like John, found fault with everybody else. And then at the bottom of one page, my memory serves me correctly, John told me not to read it, and he was sitting watching me with eyes like that as I did read it. And at the bottom of the page it said, there's nothing specifically wrong with Donald Sutherland's performance as Homer Simpson. And then I turned over the page and it said, it's just awful. And I thought, it was so non-productive. It was the most uninformed piece of criticism that I'd ever experienced. And it had no participation in my life, so I just stopped reading it from then on.
The spirit of daring that Sutherland has displayed in his choice of film roles was evident early, in brief careers in his native Nova Scotia as a sculptor and disc jockey. When he turned to acting, he studied for 10 years in London. He made his screen debut there as a witch in the Castle of the Living Dead. He attracted the attention of American audiences and filmmakers with his performance in The Dirty Dozen. He had a minor role, so minor that he had the unenviable distinction of being the only one of a dozen not to get billing on the promotional posters. But he aroused significant interest nonetheless.
A chap named Marty Bone, who now is part of the representing agency of mine, said, come to the United States. I said, can you lend me the money? He said, no, I can't lend you the money. And in the middle of the night, I phoned Christopher Plummer in Stratford, in Canada. He was doing Macbeth for Peter Coe. And I guess I must have awakened him. I was so shy and fearful of actually doing this. And I phoned him. It was 1967. And I said, do you think you could lend me $1,500? And he said, who is this? And I said, it's Donald Sutherland. I work with you in Oedipus, and I work for you in Hamlet. He said, sure, I will. Call my lawyer in the morning, and you've got it. So he gave me the money, and I ended up coming to the United States and doing MASH.
Sutherland's quirky performance as the incorrigible Hawkeye Pierce had such an effect on audiences that he hasn't stopped making movies since. He followed up that success by working with some major talents in some decidedly different roles, as a hippie tank commander with Clint Eastwood in Kelly's Heroes, as a straight arrow detective with Jane Fonda in Clute, as a legendary lover in Federico Fellini's bizarre Casanova, and recently with Jason Robards Jr. and Neil Simon's Max Dugan Returns, a romantic comedy in which Sutherland plays a policeman in love with the daughter of a con man.
Can I help you?
I'm sorry, I was looking for Miss McPhee.
Oh, she's at school.
Oh.
How'd you get in?
Well, she must have left the door unlocked. I knocked, and my name's Brian Costello. I'm a friend of hers. She left these flowers in my car the other night.
Oh, well, thank you. I'll take care of them.
Thank you.
I do our job for her now and then.
Do you? She didn't tell me. Sort of a caretaker, are you?
No. I pick up a meal here and there. Anything you want me to tell her?
No. I'll drop by the school later. Anything you want me to tell her?
Can't think of anything.
Well, it's nice to meet you, Mr.
Parker.
Parker. Good, thank you. See you. Parker! Do you do plumbing? I'm always having trouble with my plumbing.
A little out of my line. I'm moving out of state in a few days anyway.
Oh, Miss McPhee's gonna miss you. You've done just terrific work here, especially when you consider her income.
Almost everything in Sutherland's life has changed since his American debut, but not his friendship with MASH co-star Elliot Gould, with whom he has shared some off-screen scenes as comical as those the two men have done for the camera.
In this restaurant, the waiters all wore tails, and it was very, very chic. I had never been in any place like it in my life. And we were at a table for four in the center of the room with the heavy silverware. And everybody in the room was eating like that, watching us. And the two of us together were like the center of everybody's attention. And Elliot ordered a bottle of Chateau Lafite Rothschild, 1949. And the whole room was like that. And they had a sommelier and with the little silver cup, and a guy bringing the bottle, and two guys bringing glasses. And the four guys trooped across the room to our table. And they showed Elliot the bottle, and he went like that. And then they gave him the cork, and he went like that. And then they poured the wine out for him, and he went, admiring the color. No one looked at us for the rest of the day.
But that day was very unusual, for people do look at Donald Sutherland and like what they see.
If I really feel badly, I go out and walk on the street, and people come up and say, anywhere, in any city in this country, they'll say wonderful things to me, and are friendly and open, and treat me with respect and with great generosity. Really great generosity. Really, it's... And they always, somewhere in the repertoire of films that I've made, I mean, I've made about 50, they can find something that they can remember that they've liked, you know? It taxes everyone. It's terrific, in fact.
Donald Sutherland, this month in Max Dugan Returns on the Movie Channel.